I should think that last year you visited more countries than ever, isn't that right?
Yes. Oh, yes. Anyway.
Which has been your favourite one that you visited?
America, I think.
Yes,
I'll agree with that. Ringo agrees with that.
Mm-hmm. Why, particularly?
Because you make a lot.
No,
because it's good, you know. It's like Britain, only with buttons.
I see, but yes.
That's a sort of abstract
suit. It's a sort of, yeah. Well, there's more people, you know, in America, so we get big audiences and it's all wild and happy.
I remember once when we were going to go back for the second tour of America, and they were saying, oh, yeah, we're going to start in San Francisco with a ticker tape parade. And that was once when I actually did say, you know, I'm not having a ticker tape parade. You know, I mean, it was only, it seemed like a year since they just assassinated Kennedy. And I could just imagine, you know, this, how mad it is in America, you know. Got into the mania.
Right in the middle.
You know, we wrote and we recorded and we play them every day. What do you rehearse? Smiling, that's all we rehearse.
On this tour, we don't get much time, you know, to do anything.
I've just liked this kind of music for about 8 years or since it came out. It's just good, you know, good music.
I loved it. I loved all the decoy cars and, you know, all these intricate ways of getting us to the gigs.
People say, doesn't it drive you mad, all these girls screaming? I'd say, no, but if you go to a football match, a big FA Cup final, you'll see all men going, "Whoa!" We say, this is the girls' equivalent.
We did the same 30 minutes. 25, if we didn't like it, we played it fast.
Because you could never hear anything, and we were playing the repetition of all our singles, mainly, you know, just doing our hits. And then we only played 20 minutes anyway.
We never realised how fast we played when we were live. Because the adrenaline sometimes would just make you, you know, instead of All my loving. All my loving. Very fast, you know. Ooh, very hyper and all the adrenaline and talking fast. On the next song, you know.
We'd like to carry on with a song which was on our first Capitol album. We hope you enjoy the song. The song's called All My Loving.
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember I'm always true. And then while I'm away, I'll write home every day and I'll send all my letters to you. I'll pretend that I'll kiss you.
So nervous, you know. It was like going on the Palladium.
I wanted to have a live concert, and I arranged with Capitol to provide their engineers, and we recorded at Hollywood Bowl, but the techniques we had then in America was three-track half-inch, and the separation wasn't too great to begin with. You know, you had your voices in the center, but you had a mixture of drums and bass and guitars on your separate side tracks. But pervading the whole lot was the enormous welter of screams from the audience. I mean, it was like putting a microphone by the sound of by the end of a 747 jet. It was just one continual screaming sound. And it was very difficult to get a good recording out of it with the techniques we had then. And in fact, Hollywood Bowl tapes weren't issued. They didn't think it was right to do so. And it wasn't until many years later that I dug them up and refurbished them and worked on them. We did actually issue a record.
I mean, my idols were Elvis, pre-army Elvis. You know, I still think that was like the most exciting thing going. Little Richard, I was a big fan of Richard, but we'd met him in Hamburg, so we didn't have to go to America to meet Richard, but he was still a big idol. Chuck Berry, Jerry Lee Lewis, Fats Domino, we met Fats in New Orleans. He had a very big diamond watch, shape of a big, big star, you know, which was very impressive. Yeah, we started to meet these people who'd really just been in newspapers and on film, you know, actually were rubbing shoulders with them.
Well, the times, they are changing.
He was one of them.
He was our idol.
Bob was our hero.
Not an idol, but we just heard his record. As I said, we listened to his album and it really gave us a buzz, and we played it constantly, over and over and over again.
I mean, I heard of Bob through John, He played the records to me. It was just great.
I think it was freewheeling.
We love Bob Dylan.
I saw 10,000 talkers whose tongues were all broken. I saw guns and sharp swords in the hands of young children. And it's a heart, and it's a heart, and it's a heart, and it's a heart, and it's a heart. Rains are gonna fall.
So when we met him, yeah, well, you know, by that time we'd heard much more of him and knew much more about him.
It was a great honour to meet him. We had a crazy party the night we met. I went around... I thought I'd got the meaning to life that night. And I went around trying to find our roadie. Mal, get a pencil and a paper. I've got it. And Mal, because we're a bit out of it, he couldn't find a pencil and paper anywhere. But eventually, in the end of the evening, he found it, and I wrote down my message for the universe, you know. I said, now keep that. Keep that in your pocket. And Mal did. Next morning, he said, hey, Paul, he said, do you want to see that? I said, what? He said, that bit of paper. Oh, yeah. And I'd written, there are 7 levels.
Well, there was 2 men in the room, and Bob's the well-known one.
Alan Ronowitz was there, who's a journalist, who's like a mate.
That was the first time for me that I'd really smoked marijuana. And I laughed and I laughed and I laughed. It was fabulous.
Well, the times, they are changing.
I remember travelling with the boys and being almost kicked out of an aircraft by some reporters who wanted to get on. I remember being in a lift stuck between floors because too many people crowded in, and being escorted by police cars. And it was just one giant 3-ring circus from which there was no let-up. The only peace they got was when they were alone in their hotel rooms, hearing the screams outside and watching television. But that was about it. A hell of a life, really.
Yeah, there was all kinds of stuff. You know, we flew out of Montreal in order to avoid Ringo getting killed.
We were playing Canada, and they decided to make an example of me as an English Jew. Because one major fault is I'm not Jewish. And we were playing the gig, and I was always on a high riser. And I had a cop, plainclothes policeman, sitting there with me. Now, I was worried. It's the first time, it's one of the times I was really worried because I had the symbols a bit like this, you know. So give me a bit of protection. You know, usually they're like this, but I had them up. But this guy, and then I started getting hysterical because I thought, well, you know, if someone in the audience has a pop at me, I mean, what is this guy going to do? I mean, he's going to catch the bullet. What is he going to do? You know, and I just found this, it was getting funnier and funnier all the time, and this guy was just sitting there.
Yeah, it was, that kind of stuff was happening all the time. It was terrifying. And, some people would set off firecrackers in the hall, and you'd think one of the others had got shot or something.
But on stage, I always feel safe even when they break through. I don't know, it must be some kind of, you know, I just feel as though I'm all right when I'm plugged in, and I don't feel as though they get me.
If you look at any of those books that say where the Beatles were working, you find we hardly ever had a day off, you know. We'd have to complain to Brian. He'd have all the pressure of people saying, yeah, we want to book the Beatles, want to book, I've got to have them, going, making him offers he couldn't refuse. But we were having to say, we've got to have a day off, man.
We didn't get any time off. Yeah, we seemed to get 5 minutes off here and there. It might have been longer than that, but it felt like 5 minutes. But that was okay.
Well, I mean, wherever they went, there were hordes of people trying to get hold of them, trying to get their autographs, trying to touch them. It was like, I mean, everywhere they went, they were all crippled, by the way, you know? I mean, there was a sort of thing that went round, look out, fellas, cripples coming, and they wheel in all the paraplegics so they could touch them. It was like Jesus, almost.
There's no doubt there was a lot of opportunism. There were a lot of people pushing wheelchairs who were bonkers. The people in the wheelchairs were victims of whatever it was that got them in the wheelchair, and also the prisoners of these people. And that situation did become nightmarish.
There were some really bad cases, God help them, you know, but there was really some poor little children that would be brought in. I mean, some actual basket cases. I mean, they were just in baskets, you know. It's, and also some really just sad thalidomide kids.
It's not very nice to be, you know, afflicted, but, you know, John had this kind of thing that manifest as a, you know, as a joke. He'd always joke about it because the reality was too much for him. I think it was a fear or, you know, something. You can see, actually, in all these home movies, every time, you know, John, you switch the camera on and put him on, he does, goes into a spastic kind of, his interpretation of what a spastic is.
And John would always do daft clapping, you know. We couldn't really see ourselves as the sort of, yeah, come on, get on. It was only... There's a lot of that, you know. But it kept us sane, I think, you know. A little bit of irreverent humour. It meant we weren't falling for the game too much.
It's not easy. All you've got to do is sort of clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
You know, even when we got away from the screaming fans, there was all the screaming policemen and the Lord Mayors and wives and, you know, the hotel managers and his entourage. It was the only place we ever got any peace was when we got in the suite and went to the bathroom. You know, that was about the only place where you could have a bit of peace.
You know, we'll probably never do another tour like it. You know, we could never do the same as this one. And it's just been, you know, probably something we'll remember the rest of our world.
So we were always just hit and run, really. We just nipped about very quickly, and then we were back home.
You better slow down.
Today, the Beatles returned from America, where they played 32 shows in 34 days in 24 different cities. But there's no rest for the boys. In 2 weeks, they'll be back out on the road here in the UK.
John had mucked around with feedback for a while, and yes, it was intentional. He found it quite difficult to get the right amount of feedback, you know. And I think it was the first time, was it not, that feedback was used on a record? He loved things like that. He loved weird kind of effects. And it was his idea. It was great.
I seem to remember that John and George had Everly Brothers Gibsons.
Yeah, well, we had these big Gibson round sound hole electric ones.
They looked like the Everlys had used. And
they were
John. And so they were electric. They were acoustic, semi-electric, so they had electric facilities on them. And John leaned his against
the amplifier. Amp.
And then we were just going to go on and talk about the song, and suddenly the A string started feeding back a drum. We were just, what? Can you do that? You know, he said, George, where are you? I was like, on the front or something.
So but he figured out how to do it, you know, because we used to do it on stage then, live. So John figured out, you know, he just had to hit the A and I get it by the buzzing by the amp.
So that was the start
of all that. He invented Jimi Hendrix.
It probably was, actually, you know. Well, you know, once you see somebody messing with feedback, it's a whole field of research, isn't it, as it became later. Yeah. But I'm sure that's how it happened. It wasn't engineered. It came from the accident. And then we made it something we could edit onto the front.
Chaps, who are they?
Well, maybe I'll find out as the show goes on.
And most of the boys' songs today are taken from their latest LP, which is called what, Paul?
Called Beatles for Sale.
All of them.
And it's got eight of our songs, and the rest are eight from 14. What's that? Nine, please.
That's six.
I'm not very good at counting.
So I see.
Six, of course, six. Yes, eight and six.
How many GTs?
Well, I didn't get that one. Counting. Didn't get counting.
Who are the other numbers?
Kansas City.
Two Carl Perkin, one Little Richard, one Chuck Berry, and one Dr. Feelgood. And that's the rest.
What's the Chuck Berry number?
Rock and roll music, which goes on for about an hour.
We like the old numbers.
All right, well, you pick one now that isn't your own to sing for us, will you?
All right, then. Kansas City.
Speaker at their feet so they can hear what's going on. Didn't have that in those days. So the three, John, Paul and George, will be standing at microphones in front of a screaming crowd of 60,000, and Ringo will be at the back on the drums. And Ringo said to me, you know, he said, it was very difficult following. He said, I couldn't do anything clever. I couldn't do great drum kicks or anything, or drum rolls or fills. So I just had to hang on to that backbeat all the time to keep everybody together.
Film, which was great, and Dick Lester had done this kind of slightly artsy black and white thing that I think we'd all loved. So the next thing was, okay, well, what do we do now? Well, maybe a colour film.
In colour, yeah, wow, they had more money for that one.
So then things went a little bit awry, I think, because what happened then was we started saying, well, we've never been to the Bahamas, could you?
I love that. Not that any of us could ski. I mean, Dick Lester just put us on skis and edged us down a mountain.
People were sort of giving up the drink, which had been the sort of stimulant of the times, and we're getting into the herbal jazz cigarettes. And it was changing things a bit, you know, things were becoming a bit more imaginative, a little more crazy.
By then we were smoking marijuana for breakfast at that period, we were well into marijuana,
and nobody could communicate with us because it was just four glazed eyes giggling all the time, you know, in their own world.
We had fun in those days.
And I think that was one of the reasons for not learning the script. We just sort of showed up a bit stoned, you know, and sort of smiled a lot and hoped we'd get through it, you know, to get the titles good and that. And we'd had the Hard Day's Night thing, which had been Ringo just making a mistake, you know, the first time around, because he's one of those blokes who jumbles words, not meaning to. And you get a great new phrase, you know, that's better than the two he took the mixture from. So we were toying around with things like Tomorrow Never Knows, which was another of his, which we ended up using as a song title. And then I remember us all sort of sitting around trying to think of stuff, and then I think Johnson went home and came up, I think he came up with that, with Dick Lester, I think we came up with the idea of Help. And then John went home and happened to write it that evening. Wait a minute, hold on, that's wrong. John got the idea, I think, for the title Help. And I think from things he said later, I think it was a bit his state of mind. You know, he was feeling a bit constricted by the whole Beatle thing.
He never said that when he wrote it. He said it retrospectively. That was how he was feeling, and that's why he wrote that. But he was kind of plump and you know, he had his... I think that he just didn't feel right, you know?
I think it was because he felt he was a bit... I think he called it his Elvis, fat Elvis period, you know, when he was, you know, he got a bit podgy or something in his own eyes, you know, and that was depressing him a bit, you know. But I think John has, he's done interviews and articles about that, you know.
I mean, I go into these troughs every few years. It was less noticeable in the Beatles because the Beatles' image and thing would carry you through it, you know. I mean, I was in the middle of a trough in Help, you know. But you can't see it, really. I mean, I'm singing Help for a kickoff, you know. But it was less noticeable because you're protected by the image of the power of the Beatles.
Help! One, two...
Little flat up at the top of a house, in a little room I had, and I had a piano by the bed, and I just woke up one morning with this tune in my head. I thought, I don't know this tune, or do I? It's like an old jazz tune or something, and because my dad used to know a lot of old jazz stuff. Well, maybe I've just remembered it or something. So I went to the piano, found the chords to it. You know, I was like in G, F sharp minor, 7, sort of B and that. And just remembered it, made sure I remembered it. And then I just hawked it round to all my friends and stuff and said, what's this? You know, it's got to be something. It's like a good little tune, you know, and I couldn't have written it because I just dreamed it, you know. You don't get that lucky.
And it wasn't until he got the lyric together that we decided to record it. He said, how should we do it? I said, well, it's a lovely song, super song. I can't really see what Ringo can do on it. I can't really see what heavy electric guitars are going to do on it. Why don't you just go down there and sing it to me with a guitar, and we'll decide what to do with it then.
And it was good, actually, because all the others, the guys, I looked at them like, oops, I mean, you know, solo record. And they said, yeah, you know, it doesn't matter, but there's nothing we could add to it, so do it.
And so, for Paul McCartney of Liverpool, opportunity knocks.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why she had to go, I don't know. She wouldn't say. I said something wrong. Now I long for yesterday. Yesterday, love was such an easy game to play. Now I need to be place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Why she had to go, I don't know. She wouldn't say. I said something wrong. Now I long for yesterday. Yesterday, love was such an easy game to play. Now I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe yesterday.
John, listening to it, there's a particular bit where the cello moves into kind of bluesy note, and John thought that was terrific. So it was applauded, but it wasn't really a Beatle record. And I discussed this with Brian. I said, you know, this is Paul's song. Should we call it Paul McCartney? He said no.
And I can't actually remember him making that suggestion, but I wouldn't have done that. You know, we never entertain those ideas. It was sometimes tempting. You know, people would flatter you and say, oh, you know, you should get out front on the band there, or you should put this solo record out. But we always said, nah. In fact, we didn't even ever put it out as a single in England, because we were kind of a little bit embarrassed about it. We were a rock and roll band, you know, we thought we were like a little R&B combo. You tell lies, thing, and I can't see. You
can't cry, because you'll never remember me. He just wasn't in the same league for a long time. That's not putting him down. He just hadn't had the practice at writing that we had.
They'd had a lot of practice, put it that way. They'd been writing since we were at school. And so they'd written most of their bad songs. They'd written before we got into the recording studio. For me, I had to come from nowhere and start writing and to have something at least quality enough to be able to, you know, put it in the record with all the wondrous hits.
They were Don't Bother Me, I remember, kind of one of the first ones. And then he started to improve from that, and eventually became very good. You know, getting like a classic with like Something in the Way She Moves, you know, which is, I think, Frank Sinatra, I think, still refers to it as his favourite Lennon McCartney song.
Thanks, Frank.
Oh, thank you.
John Lennon, MBE.
Oh, sorry.
Ringo Starr, MBE. I'm Paul McCartney, MBE.
We were at the Twickenham Film Studios when Brian showed up one afternoon and took us to the dressing room all rather secretively, and we thought, oh, what's this about?
Brian came and said, you know, they want to give you these MBEs. We're going to accept. what do you think, boys?
And I think at first, you know, we were very impressed. We said, well, what does it mean? You know, they said, well, you become a member of the British Empire. We said, well, okay, it's a great honour. And we were honoured, genuinely.
The lowest honour that you could possibly get.
The cynicism started to creep in a little bit. And you said, well, what do you get for it? They said, well, £40 a year. We said, yeah. They said, well, and you can get to go into St. Paul's Whispering Gallery for nothing. Yeah, so how much did it cost anyway? So, about a shilling.
I can't really remember any sort of Daily Mirror reaction. How dare they? A lot of the army, that was the only other reaction, was soldiers sent theirs back.
This is a form of protest to the Queen, because this order is being debased by everybody in giving this to people who are not deserving of it.
Well, I think the Beatles have been adequately rewarded already. I mean, they've got a tremendous amount of money for what they've done.
If I had the MBE, I think I should be slightly put out of being placed on the same level as a pop singer.
I don't think it's a very good idea to return them. I can see the point in being rather surprised that people like the Beatles would be given the award.
Well, I think really it's a little ridiculous. Both sides have, well, one side has evaluated the honour too highly, and the other side, I think, too lowly. Well, this Medal of the British Empire raises a question. Where is the British Empire? I mean, purely an honorary thing. Give it to anyone you like. I think it's got any value at all.
I mean, someone always takes exception to someone else getting something.
Most people were pleased.
Yes, I think it's a very good thing because I think they deserved it and they are great.
I think they deserved it.
I think the MBE anyway is a bit of a joke. Hundreds of people have got it in the past, though I can't see any reason why the Beatles shouldn't have it. I think they're great.
Oh, I'm glad everyone's delighted.
I think they deserve everything they've got. They're very clever people, they're very clever actors.
To me, they're young, vital, and they give this country a kick and a lift. And my God, we need it.
How do you feel, John, about having the MBE?
I feel great. We're honoured.
I thought it was really thrilling that, you know, we're going to meet the Queen and they're going to give us a badge. I thought, man, this is cool.
In days gone by, they used to storm the royal palace gates demanding bread or the right to vote or some other civil right. These days, it's all for the Beatles. The mop-haired quartet received their MBEs from the Queen today. They're members of the British Empire.
Quite strange and some sort of equerry to the Queen. A guardsman, you know, took us to one side in this little side room and sort of showed us how, what we had to do. You know, you have to approach Her Majesty like this and never turn your back on her.
The other part I remember was Paul and I went up together. And first of all, she said she felt I'd started the band. I said, no, I was the last to join. And she said, well, how long have you been together? And without a blink, both Paul and I said,
we've been together now
for 40 years. And she just sort of, she had this like strange look on her face, like she wanted to like, I don't laugh, or what are they, or off with their heads, you know, I mean.
John, had you met the Queen before?
No, first time.
What did you think of you in the flesh? Did she tell you?
No, she's not going to say either way, you know, but she seemed pleasant enough to us, you know, made us relaxed.
We were standing in the line, waiting to go through. It was an enormous line, you know, hundreds of people, and we'd been grilled by the guardsmen saying, this is what you do when you get up there. And then we were so nervous that we went to the toilet, and in the toilet we smoked a cigarette, because we were all smokers in those days. But years later, I'm sure John, thinking back and remembering, oh yes, we went in the toilet and smoked, and it turned into a reefer, because, you know, what could be the worst thing you can do before you meet the Queen is smoke a reefer. But we never.
I was too stoned to remember.
Did for Great Britain, selling all that corduroy and making it swing, and they just gave us a hoodie old leather medal with wooden string through it.
It was like this whole momentum was going, you know, that had been going for years and it just kept rolling.
And now we were playing stadiums.
You know, that was in the days when people were still playing the Finsbury Park Astoria, you know, and to play at Shea Stadium.
Shea Stadium.
Street, decorated by their queen, and loved here in America. Here are...
Mm-hmm.